Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm truly delighted to be participating in this event, which for me is a cause for celebration. In a society like ours, shaped by colonialism, where people are affected by superiority and inferiority complexes, there is always the danger of concentrating on trite issues, losing focus, and not appreciating the gems in our midst. Without any apology to anyone, I would like to acknowledge Professor Sir Howard Fergus as a gift to Montserrat, a gift that keeps on giving. And why do I say this? And I wasn't paid to do so. I think it's important for me to explain what I mean. Our history in the New World is short, and a lot of it is unwritten or written from someone else's perspective. We can now boast hundreds of graduates, but unfortunately, there are not that many who are actually doing research and making the results of that research available for improving our understanding of our peculiar history and how it affects our society today. Sir Howard has been one of the very few graduates who has done this and continues to do so. In the preface to this new publication, he mentions that this is his 9th Montserrat monograph, and I figure that he is excluding his autobiography, which thankfully has been reprinted and will be made available this evening. This book is a sociological study which every Montserratian should read. I was not asked to promote this work or any of his books, but once a librarian, always a librarian. Every student, every resident, including those now making Montserrat their home, should get copies of Sir Howard's publications and begin the process of understanding the society in which we find ourselves today. So here is a man who, though retired, continues with remarkable and enviable energy and vigor to fill the various gaps in our story. In any 1 year, you can expect at least 2 publications, and this is no exaggeration. This evening provides the evidence. He spoke about the Obama and Other Poems, which was just released. And now we are looking at Festival at 50, 1962 to 2012. Publishing is an expensive venture, and we are well aware of the serious shortcomings of this industry in Montserrat. In fact, these shortcomings are not limited to Montserrat, but plague most of the Caribbean. The industry is fragmented, the skills needed to make it strong and vibrant are very often lacking or weak, and in many countries, as in Montserrat, there is no established publisher. There is no agency that will take your manuscript through the various stages of the industry. Many Caribbean authors are in fact self-publishing to crack industry barriers, even though they're well aware that having a publisher accept their manuscript has its advantages. The publisher usually has the resources to acquire the best skills for designing, editing, and marketing the publication. Now, Festival at 50, Sir Howard tells us, was something of an afterthought, pressure cooked in an effort to serve it up at festival time. He would have experienced some difficulty with his research since we currently do not pay much attention to documentation and archiving. He explains that he resorted in many cases to oral history. We understand the rush because printing on island is unaffordable, and those in the business here will tell you exactly that when you take your project to them. Paper is imported and there are duties on it. If there is an expectation that the industry will develop here, government will have to revisit this policy. The printing has to take place overseas, and this means you are now considering the cost of shipping as well as the potential logistical nightmare this can be. I'm still waiting for a letter that was sent to me since last year, October, from the US. And I'm now waiting for more than 2 months for mail out of the UK. When you take these issues into consideration, you start understanding the value of the contribution that Sir Howard has made to Montserrat. In the foreword, the Premier does speak to Sir Howard's sterling contribution. We acknowledge that books are published to enlighten, to inform, to entertain, and father stole the words out of my mouth. Anyone feeling strongly that he or she has something important to say, something that adds value and enriches the world, has a reason for publishing. Sir Howard has taken the bold step of providing a document that records the development of the Christmas Festival from 1962 to 2012. He was supported in this venture by Lime, the Office of the Premier, the Montserrat Tourist Board, the Montserrat Foundation, and the Ministry of Education, and they are all to be congratulated. The book is dedicated to Clifford Tuitt and to Julian Roberts Riley. And interestingly, in an email exchange with Merle Roach, to whom I'd mentioned the launch, she said, and I quote, "Oh great, can't wait to read it. I hope he has dedicated a chapter to the costume builders. Clifford Tuitt, Jolin, Jim Taylor, Rexford Davis, Errol Eade, Butler, etc. I always feel they get overshadowed by Calypsonians and Queens." Not only is she endorsing what Sir Howard has done, and I wouldn't say that great minds think alike, but she's excited about the publication, and that has been the response all around. Monster Russians at home and abroad are already eager to get their hands on the book. The book also has everybody strolling down memory lane, myself included. In fact, the photo on the cover of Clifford in costume, the dedication, and later the section on him, had me remembering my undergraduate days at Mona in Jamaica. Clifford would very regularly visit me on campus, and I remember when we were both coming to the end of our studies, we had plans that we would mount an exhibition of selections from his portfolio in the public library where I would be working. When I heard of his passing, I cried as I've never cried over any such news. I cried for the excitement that we shared over plans that would never materialize. I cried because he had such dreams and would never see them come to fruition. Thanks, Sir Howard, for letting the memory of this talented and dedicated monster live on in this book. It would be nice if we had the portfolio for the Montserrat Museum. Now, the book unfortunately has editorial flaws, and Sir Howard intends to include an errata note. However, I feel that we are willing to excuse the errors simply because we would choose to have the book with the flaws rather than not have it at all for celebrating the 50th anniversary. When you're originally thinking of printing in China, you have to provide a long timeline to ensure that the work gets back to Montserrat. Of course, if we were all clairvoyant, we would do things differently, and Sir Howard would have had more time for the editorial process. But we do have a book in hand, and its title, Cover Design and the Obvious Connection Between These Two, with a Hint of Gold on the cover, the structure of the book with 7 chapters, useful appendices, list of references, and the use of photographs, many of them in color, all meet industry standards. While it doesn't include an index which would have facilitated finding information in the book, it must be noted that it's only 145 pages in length, and the contents page does accomplish this to some extent. There are omissions as well, but I personally feel that these add to the value of the book. Let me explain. The book provides a platform for discussion and for reminiscing. As I read through, I started remembering things I'd long forgotten. For example, I'd forgotten that my sister Ernestine had entered the Queen Show in 1986. I was actually in the UK studying, so I missed the event. And while that information is not in this volume, when the Queen that year, Pauline Wall, is mentioned in chapter 3, the memories came back. In fact, I now remember that I actually inherited the swimsuit that Ernie had worn in the competition. Time has been most cruel. I also remember Ernie telling me that the staff at the tourist board worked hard in 1997 to pull off the Christmas festival after there was a massive dome collapse on Boxing Day. In an article, Festival Still Alive, in the Montserrat Reporter, Kathy Buffon, to whom we owe a debt of gratitude for helping to document these events, mentions a T-shirt logo, Monstrations jamming all over, volcano blowing. Yes. This was part of the T-shirt troupe that replaced the usual costume bands. And I remember coming off the ferry and going to the Festival Day show at Gerald's Park that year. In chatting with Jane Grell about the book, she too started recalling her childhood experiences of Christmas. She remembered her brother, Calvin Grell, and cousin, David Burke, who was recently on Rose's cultural show, all entered the Endeavor Club's children's costume competition. It seemed the theme was Cinderella, and Calvin appeared as an attendant to the prince and won. She also recalled watching the jump up when the music came from a mobile steel pan unit that had to be pulled or pushed, a unit on wheels. She asked if Bob Riley and Titus were mentioned in the book, and I confirmed that they were, and she reminded me of something else that I'd forgotten, that Titus was later hired to train girls. He trained them to walk, those girls who were entering beauty competitions. There is so much that we forget, But this publication, Festival at 50, will assist with reawakening dormant memories. In chapter one, Christmas Before Festival, we get a history of Christmas celebrations before 1962. It documents the various activities that were part of the Christmas season. It looks at Christmas activities during the days of slavery and after, the masquerades and other folk figures like Miss Lucy and Bo, and discusses serenading. I remember going with my younger sister and brothers. I was always telling them, let's go on an adventure, and they would follow me. And we would go on people's veranda to sing. And usually when I approach the door and start to sing, I look on and there was nobody else. On pages 7 to 8, the slaughter of pigs on Christmas Eve is discussed, and this awakened a not-so-distant memory. Just about 3 years ago, I discovered that a Christmas tradition coming out of St. Patrick's is still being observed here in the North. On Christmas Eve, men originally from the South, all dressed in jacket and tie, assist with killing, gutting, and cleaning a pig. Black pudding is then made, and the jumbo table is set with the delicacies. Of course, my camera failed to work the next day when I wanted to capture the jumbo table, which was very artistically arranged with cheese, cassava, drink, all the things mentioned in the book. There are some recollections which are not all clear. For example, on page 16, Miss Goosey is described as a woman puppet built on a wooden frame. While this is true of last year's Miss Goosey and possibly previous ones, I have a childhood recollection that Miss Goosey was actually a man on stilts manipulating long arms. So this is a discussion that has to take place. The book Festival of 50 will stimulate the conversation that will hopefully lead to clarity for those of us with uncertain memories. I also see chapter one serving as a catalyst for further research. It raises all kinds of questions. Are there other explanations for extending the Christmas holiday for the enslaved? Why did the masquerade troops avoid the Catholic South? How much do we know about the enslaved Africans who ended up in Montserrat? Are there other details of the connections between a West African culture and the figures that appeared at Christmas? These are some of the issues that somebody should be encouraged to research. I found that chapter two, which looks at the origins of festival, highlights information that was completely new for me. I am aware of Mary Truitt's role as a female parliamentarian in Montserrat. I wasn't aware that she played such an important role in the development of festival. And I found this particularly important piece of information. You start seeing the connections and family relationships between some of the movers and shakers in the history of Montserrat's festival. Many see names like Clifford Truitt and Carol Truitt, and then Hunter, Alaric, and Glendina. A picture emerges. The section of this chapter covering the creative talents provides details of the contributions of these persons and makes the book all the more interesting for the reader. Chapter three, The Face of Beauty, will no doubt have people rushing to get to this section of the book to learn all about the Queen shows over the years. Of course, the memory for me has to do with Arrow's sentiments that the Calypso show was never valued in the same way as the Queen show. And this issue is also mentioned in the book. According to Arrow, this was in an interview in 2002. He told me that his song when he first participated in the Calypso competition was entitled Coops de Coops. The words are as follows, and I'm not going to try to sing. When them queen contestants come on stage, they coops, tick coops, tick coops. All them queens do is pose. We have to bust we head to compose. Yet when we finish sing, the queens get everything. He explained that he was just appealing to the Jaycees to be fair to the Calypsonians. Now the chapter four on the Calypsonians provides a very useful analysis of the work of the greats. But of course, I took the usual stroll down memory lane recalling experiences at Calypso shows. The 1970s, when the whole world was affected by the oil shortage, and the songs that year spoke to that issue. I remember Falcon, at school we call him Madoc, sang Save Energy, and on stage he ditched his motorcycle and went off on a donkey. Those were the days. This chapter also reminds me of the interesting stories about those who write the calypsos. I don't know how true this is, but I've been told that Cupid, for example, often writes several of the songs each year. And in some cases, the people who sing his songs do better than he does. Names like Franklin Michael come to mind. The book provides some of this information, but I'm sure the discussions will lead to even more names emerging. Chapter 5, Other Faces of Festival. I was really pleased to learn about the work of Sunrise Productions, but I'm not going to tell you about it. Buy the book. I had to check my recollection, and it was confirmed that Arrow would indeed use the Christmas season to release a new album at the disco. According to Merle, in the late 80s, Arrow always launched his new album at 747 Disco, and it was most often the first weekend in December, which was like the unofficial start of festival. The section covering the costume bands had me laughing at yet another memory. This has to do with the library's participation in the Christmas Children's Festival in 1993, I think. We used the theme Sable Beaches, which we had used for the Children's Library summer program that year. Jane Grell and I spent many nights into the wee hours of the morning sewing costumes, and I was laughing because I used to go to sewing class with the nuns, and I was told that I had no talent whatsoever. So there I was, supposedly making costumes, stitching, and it was funny for me. And I was aware of the controversy when we actually won first place, because let's admit it, they were better crafted costumes. However, I think what gave us the edge was that we brought drama to the stage. Something I thought was copying ever since I witnessed Mitchell's Mancrab trilogy in Trinidad in 1984. And the action was accompanied by Sonia Osborne's wonderful narration. Sir Howard speaks in the book about the involvement of individuals from other islands in the development of festival in Montserrat. And I suddenly recalled a Mr. Agaro, a Trinidadian teacher at the Maple Leaf School, who with Mr. Raghunandan worked with students to prepare a costume band for the school in 1970. This was the first time that I was in a troupe, and it has only now dawned on me that there was also drama on stage then. I'd forgotten that. We were all in grass skirts, and the men out on the hunt speared a papier-mâché pig on stage after doing a dance around it. Now, in chapter 6, Economic Implications, Sir Howard reiterates what he says in the preface, that festival is human and material investment, and investment is a palpable and bankable concept which suggests future profit. And I support this view, since it speaks to the objectives of the Aludana Festival of the World and all the preparations that went into it. Two workshops in event planning, one in storytelling, and a proposal which was later passed on to the MDC for product development and packaging. It is not just culture as a commodity, but the totality of cultural and creative industries that can possibly take the region onto a more sustainable development path. Chapter 7, The Afterword, provides further fodder for future discussions. Should there be paid service or volunteerism for festival? Should there be a new format for festival? These discussions will no doubt feed into the cultural policy that is being developed at this time. In concluding, I would just like to say that book production is recognized as a cultural industry that fosters an intellectual tradition as well as national identity and pride. It supports education. Let us recognize the massive contribution that Professor Sir Howard has made by producing another valuable work. Congratulations, Sir Howard, and thank you.